This is Tim Pierce. That's the actual guitar part that I played on the day that I was lucky enough to track that song live with Phil Collins. The song is You'll Be In My Heart. For Phil, it was a big song. It won him the Academy Award. For me, it was a dream come true. It was the beginning of 4 years of recording with Phil, including a trip to Switzerland to do his next solo record. Rob Cavallo joins us for the story. Click the link below if you want to check out the online masterclass.
We're here again.
We did City of Angels before You'll Be In My Heart, didn't we?
Yeah. And I think three years before.
And that was Iris by the Goo Goo Dolls and Uninvited by Alanis Morissette.
Yeah.
And then...
it was 1 year before.
It was just right before it.
It was right before it, yeah. Okay. 1 year.
Okay. So you became a go-to guy for songs and movies that were huge hits.
Yeah. It's a really cool thing when the movie industry kind of gets wind of you, and the way they figured it out with me was that on City of Angels, at first there wasn't even going to be a soundtrack. And then all of a sudden I had the Goo Goo Dolls write a song and Alanis Morissette write a song, which is of course highlighted in the last video. And both those songs went to number one and the soundtrack sold 18 million copies, which is kind of amazing. So then Hollywood goes, oh, this guy, he can put a hit song in your movie. He put two in that one. Maybe we'll even just, you know, if we can get a half a hit on the next one, you know, hire that guy, you know.
It's amazing how simple the actual equation is for getting work.
Yeah, just do it once. I mean, the next thing you know, Austin Powers or you know, Mission Impossible or, you know, Runaway Bride or...
I remember we did Eric Clapton, we did Kiss,
we did Ghosting. The Pretenders, we did all these Gary Marshall movies and Jerry Bruckheimer movies.
Yeah, it's great.
Because I was at Disney at the time.
So what Rob's talking about is after the success of Iris, which we did for the Goo Goo Dolls and City of Angels, there was a run of movie songs that we did. We were kind of a wrecking crew for movie songs. My favorite, one of my favorites, was this Eric Clapton song we did called Blue Eyes Blue. He played this amazing acoustic solo and sang it. Beautiful song for Runaway Bride. And I got to do the rhythm guitar parts and Clapton did the lead.
And actually this is one of the big Disney ones where they were like, hey Rob, we got these 8 songs that Phil Collins wrote. For this movie Tarzan, it's a animated feature. You think you could turn any of these into a single, you know? And they couldn't believe that I actually picked You'll Be In My Heart at first, because at that time, as opposed to all the other ones, which had drums and bass and were kind of up, it was just an A-tempo ballad where Phil and Glenn Close was actually singing it like, you know, come stop your crying, it'll be all right. Right, you know, the first thing I usually do is I learn how to play the song, I learn the chords, and the song was in G, you know, come stop your crying, it'll be all right. And I was like, well, what's, yeah. And I'm like, well, what's cool, like, what's a cool song that I know that's in G? I mean, that's literally, in a way, like, how dumb you can be. But also smart. I was like, what G? And I was like, oh, I know. Honky Tonk Woman, Stones, is actually one of my favorite songs in G, which is sort of like... Right, so thank you, Stones. It was really... Keith, it was actually you who got me to, you know, you know, gave me the inspiration to figure out how to put a rhythm to that melody.
I was a huge Genesis fan and a huge Phil Collins fan growing up, listening to every iteration of Genesis. And then moving here to L.A., watching Phil become a huge solo artist, listening to all that music, loving it. At a certain point, I get a call. We're going in with Phil Collins. I say, okay. I show up at the studio. He's tuning his drums. And there's that sound I've heard my whole life right in front of me. And then later we're tracking, and I'm looking at him, and I'm playing guitar, he's playing drums, there's a band going. I was in utter disbelief at the fact that I was hearing that same sound. It never changes. It was him and his sound in his pocket, and me playing guitar, me having the privilege of playing guitar with him. Later that day, his tour manager says, hey, how do you feel about going on the road? Can't really go on the road when you're a session guy because you lose all that session work. You can't really do it, so couldn't do that. But that song won him an Academy Award. Best song in a motion picture that year, and a Golden Globe. And he was so happy about all that, he invited us to Switzerland to do his next solo record. We went for a month. It was awesome. We did another movie after that. But the greatest moment was that day in the studio, hearing that sound come out of his drums, that sound I'd heard my whole life, and then tracking, looking over at the drummer, and it's Phil Collins. I couldn't believe it.
So it was cool. There was this guy, Chris Montana, who was the head of music for Disney Animation. And I called him and I said, I think you'll be in my heart. And I think I have a way of doing it. And I played him this over the phone and he was like, oh, that's great. You know, Phil is actually in a studio across town. Why don't you just bring your guitar, get in the car, let's fucking go. So I jump, I'm all excited. I'm like, oh my God, I'm gonna see Phil Collins. I'm gonna play him, you know, and you know, show him what I think the song might be. So we get there. I see him in the parking lot. I go to my trunk. The guitar is not there. I was so fucking panicked that I didn't even bring the guitar. And
how are you going to sell it then?
I thought, well, it's a studio. They have to have a guitar somewhere. And of course, we get in there and I say hi to Phil. And it's the second time I've met him. And he's really sweet. He's really nice. And, you know, he knew I was like nervous, super nervous. And then, so we're asking around for a guitar. There isn't one, but there's a piano. So I like jump on the piano and try to do it, you know, and I'm like, I go, it's a rhythm, you know, come stop your cry. And he immediately picks it up and he sits right next to me. I mean, boom, right here. And he starts playing it. And then the next thing you know, I'm sort of like, I'm like off the piano. I mean, I was like, oh, dude, you take it, man. And he just played the whole song and he just looked up at me and said, right, let's cut it.
And when you had met him before, you told me he tested your musicality, right?
He did, yeah. He was like, you know, if you're in the key of G sharp, you know, like, what's the dominant fifth, you know? And I was like, it'll be D sharp seven. He was like, okay, good. When you're in the studio and you're learning how to play a song, you know, there was no real proper demo for this song. It was only an A-tempo ballad. So from where the song started to where it ended was quite a large leap. And so for the, you know, we got there, we got sounds up and it was like 12:30 or whatever and in the afternoon. And now it's 2:30 in the afternoon and we keep playing the song and we're not getting anywhere. It's just not working, guys. It was not sounding good. It was just asleep. And you probably are going, what are you talking about? Well, it just sounded dead. Everyone was being just very respectful. And the only demo there was at that point was an A-tempo ballad. So we got a tempo, and we moved it from here to here. And we were probably playing it too slow. And I remember Chris Montan saying, I just saw the look in his face. Because it takes like 3 or 4 years to animate by hand every frame. And the Walt Disney Company puts in like, you know, $150, $200 million investment into one of these things. And they need a hit. And it's Chris Montan's job to get one. So he had a meeting that he had to go to at like 3 o'clock. And I just remember him just walking away going, oh, we're fucked. And I see him walking down the, you know, at Conway, this beautiful, you know, sort of sidewalk you walk through the garden and his shoulders are down. He's dejected, you know. And he says, I'll be back at like 4:30 or 5.
So Chris Montan, as head of Disney Music, was responsible for overseeing all their films and all the major artists that worked on those films. There were a lot of them, including Phil Collins. But the great thing about Chris is he started out as a touring musician. He became a recording artist with a record deal, went through that process, and then was also a professional songwriter and had successful covers. So when you work with somebody like Chris, you're working with an ally. He's one of us. He understands us. And if you have a problem, he can help you solve it. But more than that, he actually respects musicians. And you always feel that when you're working with him. So as an executive, Chris, definitely best case scenario.
So now we're making the record and we're trying. And finally, I was like, guys, okay, you know what? Why don't we just try it? Let's just break the glass ceiling. Let's just play it like we're in the band Kiss. I don't care if we overdo it, but I want us to do the Kiss version of this song. Let's raise the tempo 10 BPMs or 12 or whatever. Everyone's like, right, let's do it, because otherwise we just look like a bunch of sad sacks. And we raised the loops because we had a couple of loops, and all of a sudden, boom, we had the record. And everyone it just materialized. Mm-hmm. Everyone played. We played it probably 5 or 6 more times. We got the take. And I remember now it's like 4:30 and I see Chris Montan and he's walking. His shoulders are down. He's walking back to the studio and he comes in and he looks like he wants to kill himself. And we're all like, hey, Chris. And he's like, what? I was like, we got it. He's like, really, really? And we played him the song. And then he was just high-fiving us. He's like, holy shit, this is a number one record.
The Oscar goes to Phil Collins for You'll Be in My Heart.
Now my life can go on, I think. Boy, it's been hell, I tell you.
There was another sweet moment where at the end of the first chorus, I was like, Phil, right there before we go, before we pop back in into the key change, back into the, you can do a Phil. We have an opportunity to do a classic Phil Collins Phil. And he was like, oh my God, right. And he goes, oh, this is what you do. And Elliot Shiner, I think, was the engineer, who's brilliant. And he goes, send to 2 tracks, the overheads and the tom mics. And he goes out and he just goes da 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 on the toms, right? And I'm like, he's like, hold on. He goes, give me 2 more tracks. Pan them over to the right. And then he goes da 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 da, right? And he goes, now play it back and pan them hard left and right. And then if you listen to the drums to this day, you're going to hear da 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 da, boom, right? Which is a classic Phil Collins film. We were like, it's fucking genius that he just did it like in 2 seconds. So now we've got a really good basic track, and Phil has sung it, and it was really a pretty great thing. But what we didn't have were the strings, and I always liked hiring David Campbell, and you basically, you know, you're spending like, you know, anyway, in this case, I think because it was 36 strings, and I liked having double basses, you know, I had 3 or 4 double basses because I really wanted to get that.
You can hear it.
And you have 16 violins, and you know, and 12 cellos and 8 violas, then, you know, if you have 3 double basses. Anyways, we had a little extra sized sort of rock symphony, string symphony. And, you know, you get 3 hours to do it, and we're hiring all the best players. So it's like 30 or 40 grand, whatever it is that costs, right? Which is maybe to some people not a lot of money, but we have to get it right. And there was a time deadline. So anyways, there's this funny picture where Phil and I are at the desk. We're at Capital A. And I think Paula Salvatore, the studio manager, says, "Hey guys," and we both turn around and she snaps the picture. Anyways, both of our armpits are totally sweaty. We were so nervous. You know, it's like, why would we be sweating? Hopefully I can find that picture. The reason why we're sweating is because we know how much is on the line and how much we want to get it right, you know. And we have 3 hours to do it. And anyways, this is one that turned out great, because obviously I think it was like something ridiculous, like 19 weeks at number one, which is kind of an amazing thing, because that's 4 months at number one. And it set some records at AC Radio. And of course, the biggest one is that it won the Oscar Best Song Written for a Motion Picture. So that was great. And we sold heaps of records, many millions and such.
Thanks for watching. If you haven't subscribed yet, please hit the subscribe button and ring the bell. If you are a subscriber, please ring the bell. It lets us let you know every time a new video is released. You can also support us by clicking the link below for the online masterclass. As I always say, we're up to over 100 hours of lessons and content, over 1,000 videos. There's a 14-day free trial. Take your time, take a long look. We'd love to have you join us.